And as you know, in April, we announced that we were reviewing our position on the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. And today I can announce that the United States is lending its support to this declaration.
We the people.
Hello, this is Patrick with New Jersey's Outdoor Adventures YouTube channel. Just taking my mountain bike along some of the trails here in Tinton Falls, New Jersey. And someone had mentioned this to me earlier, that there was almost like an abandoned cemetery called Shadows Rest off of Ruffin Court in Tinton Falls. It's closer to the border of Colts Neck.
This is just one of my family's burial grounds, which has been falsely recorded in history as an African-American cemetery.
I believe this was one of the first African-American graveyards or cemeteries in the area.
We still here. We never left.
Because of all the thousands of people that I've met over my years, conversations with people that look like African-American people. And when you really get down to the nit and the grit of it and ask them, what's your ancestry? Oh, my grandma was a Cherokee, or my great-great-grandfather was, I think he was a Seminole. And because of the stolen heritage of American Indians with black blood and black people with Indian blood, I felt that it was time that black folks with Indian blood and Indian folks with black blood were able to come together as a people and not feel ridiculed, marginalized, or subjugated because they stood up and told the world who they are.
Come out your shells, turtles. The world's waiting.
Their mahogany skin shown through.
They know who we are. Ain't no need to argue with them.
These dark angels would make exceptional wives for the English planters, and their dark skin would bleach out in two generations, unquote. That's a quote that he made.
So that was the whole goal, was to try to bleach out, as they say.
Yeah, but it kind of tells you that first Americans were a rich brown people.
Mm-hmm.
They were mahogany in color.
Mama knew what she was talking about, but I always thought that she wanted to be something that we wasn't. And I remember I used to say, Mama, we black.
Other than the cultural assimilation over the years, what's more respectful, being a Negro or a black man?
She said, I don't care if black. She said, you see any. I will never forget that. I was about 7 years old.
I knew already where it came from.
I may be poor, but I am somebody.
African American, black, Negro, colored, mulatto, all brains placed on you by your oppressor to strip you of your nationality.
Somebody, men, if you really believe that you're inferior, you really believe that black is supposed to stay back and white is right. Many of you have given up on being first-class citizens. You've given up on 3 meals a day. You've given up because somebody has defined you as a white man's slave rather than God's child. You're not put here to be a white man's footstool. You're put here to represent the very best in God's word.
As rich as our past history is, what is wrong with being referred to as a Negro?
I ain't saying I'm not black. I'm a Native American from this country.
I'm not from Africa. I'm a full-blooded American.
Thank you. sometimes you can distinguish what the names are, and sometimes you can't. Sometimes it's just a stone that tells you that there were people buried there.
Blacks could not be buried alongside whites. That's how the law was. That's how it was during that time.
At the end of a cul-de-sac in Tinton Falls, New Jersey, a historic cemetery is slowly being reclaimed by nature.
Well, I think I can see some stones back here. It's been a while. I haven't been here in about 10 years.
Lawrence Walker is a historian who has studied some of the 60-plus African-American cemeteries in New Jersey.
A lot of rich history that is here. It's American history.
He believes this particular one dates back as far as the 1700s.
This is historic ground right here. This is a historic cemetery. People ask me, well, why do you say that? Because of the prominent people that are buried right here in the cemetery. You have, from my records, you have good 30 veterans of the Civil War, United States colored troops that are buried there, World War I, World War II, most of them African American, as well as Native Americans that are buried in this cemetery. And prominent people within this community that probably escaped from the Underground Railroad, some decided to settle right in this area and identify them, this is home, this is where I'm gonna stop running, you know. You know, some things are probably covered up that will never be identified. And you're wiping out a lot of important history.
Red Bank, New Jersey, a small city nestled safely on the banks of the Navesink River. Red Bank was a fairly safe place to grow up, although like any other place in America.
Holy shit! This is fucking stupid! Whoa! What the fuck are you doing, dude? What are you doing?
We put an ad in a paper called the Red Bank Register. It was a woman in Highlands looking for a babysitter. I knock on the door, and the woman opens the door, and she's obviously dressed to go out for the evening, you know, decked out. She looks me up and down, I mean up and down. She says, what do you want? And I said, you know, I'm here to babysit. And she says, you most certainly are not. And she slammed the door in my face.
Red Bank was originally formed as a town on March 17, 1870. On March 14, 1879, Red Bank became Shrewsbury City, a portion of Shrewsbury Township. But this only lasted until May 15, 1879. On March 10, 1908, Red Bank was formed as a borough by the Act of the New Jersey Legislature and was set off from Shrewsbury Township. The borough was named for the red soil along the Navesink River. Occupied by indigenous people for thousands of years. In historic times, the area of modern-day Red Bank was the territory of the Algonquin-speaking Lenni Lenape Native Americans, also called the Delaware by the English. The Lenape lived in the area between the Navesink River and the Shrewsbury River, in an area that they called Navarumpsum.
When the ancient ones arrived here, one of the things that probably caused their journey to end was the fact that the land ended. You know, this was the edge of the continent. This was where the sun rose, and therefore this was the location of where we wound up. What caused us to spread out over Lenape Hoking was probably just simply the plentiful nature of the food sources, the abundance in the forests, the abundance in the waterways, materials to make homes, clothing, everything that was needed.
Local Lenape and Nanticoke Indian tribes encountered European exporters and settlers as early as the middle 15 and 1600s. As the communities grew, many Indian families moved west and are located today in Oklahoma, Wisconsin, and Canada. The Rocks are one of the few families who remained.
Those of us who stayed, especially those of us who stayed here in southern New Jersey, have been referred to by tradition by our northern relatives up in Canada as the keepers of the land. That there were families that had partially assimilated, adopted Christianity. Some had gotten deeds to ancient lands that their families had been on for years, and they stayed put. And we are the remnant that stayed put. And the belief was that we would always hold on to the place where the dust of our ancestors' bones.
This is from a book entitled Red Bank on the Navajo. I came across the names of three families who are descendants of the Lenni Lenape Nation, and I found this irresistible. The Reeves, the Rocks, and the Richardsons were three families that could trace their lineage back to the Lenni Lenape Indians. So I closed my eyes and stabbed the name of Arnold Rock with a ballpoint. And a few days later, presented myself at his Echo Press on West Bergen Place in Red Bank, New Jersey.
We go back a long time in Red Bank anyway.
Mm-hmm.
My grandfather had the print shop in Red Bank for all the years that he did.
Wow.
As long as I can remember, I was thrown behind the print shop, the machines, picking up type, learning the business of what printing was all about. Okay? When we lost my grandfather in 1976, it was like a heartbreak for us.
Mm-hmm.
And it was all of a sudden. You know what I mean? The days and the months, we have been looking into our history. Okay? Even when I take the census report or fill out job applications, I put Native American, Afro-American.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
Because we are from the first limits of the Lenni Lenape Indians.
Right.
Okay? So that bloodline runs right through us.
Right.
Okay? So, most of us are still in the area. We have a few that are outside of the area. But what I'm saying, and keep yourself, I'm just glad to be here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad to get to know who my people really are.
Right.
Okay? Because I think it's very important today to where the world is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? In the meantime, enjoy yourself. Thanks for putting this on Facebook. It's been a beautiful day so far for me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I wouldn't change it for the world.
So what's going on here? What is that about? Where is that history? I'll show you in a few minutes, and we're going to have a conversation, and I'm going to show you some more things that the Smithsonian science, government, commerce colluded to erase.
What's more respectful, being a Negro or a black man?
Bin ich Deutscher?
Nein.
Bin ich Amerikaner?
Nein.
You know, I'm doing research right now to try to find out.
Naja, geht noch.
Ich bitte dich, er ist doch eindeutig nicht in Amerika geboren worden.
Aber ich habe Amerika besucht, richtig?
Ja.
I know already where it came from.
War dieser Besuch erfreulich?
Nicht für Sie.
Afro-American, black.
Also Herrschaften, an dieser Stelle könnte man fragen, ob man real oder erfunden ist. Ich finde diese Frage aber zu einfach und frage noch nicht danach. Ich bin...
You know me.
Als ich aus dem Urwald nach Amerika kam, fuhr ich da mit dem Schiff?
Ja.
Geschah die Reise gegen meinen Willen?
Ja. Yeah.
As rich as our past history is.
Auf der Schiffsreise lag ich da in Ketten.
Ja.
What is wrong with being referred to as a Negro?
Als ich in Amerika ankam, wurde ich da in Ketten zur Schau gestellt.
Ja.
Bin ich die Geschichte des Negers in Amerika?
Nein.
Also dann muss ich King Kong sein.
Ah! Oh. Bravo!
Instead of being able to tell the story of their great nations that they built before the white man came to America, the black Native Americans were instead enslaved, and in slavery they remained.
In 1912,
Dr. Walter Plecker became the first director of the Bureau of Vital Statistics. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, there were no birth certificates, and he was a director up until the 1940s, 1946, yeah. Until his death. But he was part of the eugenics movement, which was a movement about creating one race of people, which was white, and everything else was put in a pot, as Tina Marie must say, and stir it up and call colored. Mm-hmm. But he went beyond board on that, wherein, as far as first Americans are concerned, he changed birth certificates and marriage license. He even put out letters to census takers in 1930 that people such as myself that are first Americans and Native Americans, that he considered us as being bastards, that we were just trying to be Indian to marry into the white race.
But basically, when he was the registrar for the Bureau of Vital Records, he changed the names of Indian people in Southampton County,
exactly.
Their race, from Indian to Negro or colored.
No, it was referred to as colored. And basically all the tribes in Virginia in the early 1900s were referred to as colored, okay? Then after the 1924 Racial Integrity Act, everything that was in that colored bowl became Negro.
Census takers in the late 1800s listed them as Negro or Black, removing their Native American identities with the stroke of a pen.
I used to ask my mother, I said, why is my grandfather so quiet? He never had much to say, mm-hmm. And it's coming pretty clear to me as why he was so quiet.
Because at that time, they did not talk about being Indians because right. You could be jailed, correct?
Exactly. Right. There was a lot of bad things that could have happened to you if you were Native and if you were caught off the reservation. In some cases, you could be shot on sight. And that's one of the reasons why in 1968, the Supreme Court overthrew that Racial Integrity Act and gave Native Americans the right, if they were born before July 1960, to come forward to the Bureau of Indian Affairs and correct those records that have been changed.
People don't know Natives come looking different ways, and it took me a long time to realize that. This is where the Native Americans of color is right here on this side of the town. What's that?
What nation are you from?
I'm Cherokee.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, from Georgia.
I'm one of my nations. I'm Lenape, but the other three grandparents, I don't know what nation they were from.
Oh, yeah, Lenape. Yeah, I think I knew you from here, from the last powwow.
Yeah.
I was here, but I didn't have it on my regalia.
I got to see this brother up close. He is
Oh, yeah, thank you. I'm the real deal.
Do you know it? Did you know that?
How things were done to actually change, not only to change one's race, but to change one's ethnicity, to take away their traditions, to take away their cultures, etc.
So the concept was to classify people according to their appearance, basically their skin color, regardless of their pedigree or their lineage. It's called denationalization.
The eugenics movement was white supremacy cloaked in science. Its supporters were many and influential, from leading academics at University of Virginia to wealthy industrialists. The Richmond Times-Dispatch editorialized in 1924 that racial intermingling would ruin the white man. Quote, once a drop of inferior blood gets in his veins, he descends lower and lower in the mongrel scale. That was the year the General Assembly passed the Racial Integrity Act, narrowly defining race and making it illegal for whites to marry anyone of any other race. Plecker wrote to the governors of the rest of the states, urging them to pass similar laws to save the white race. The Racial Integrity Act, which Plecker pushed, stood until 1967, when the appropriately named Loving case about an interracial couple led to a U.S. Supreme Court reversal. But the damage to Virginia's Indian tribes continues. There are more than 560 federally recognized Indian tribes in the country, but none of Virginia's tribes, the ones that helped the settlers survive, have that crucial recognition, because Walter Plecker did everything he could to destroy evidence of their existence.
Everybody feels bad for Indians. They get dogged openly because everybody thinks they're dead.
Walter Plecker and the eugenics movement was the disease that killed off all the Indians. Paper genocide was committed against the indigenous populations of North America, and we are currently identified as African American, formerly Negro and formerly colored. We are not dead.
These motherfuckers are not all dead, all right?
He told them that they weren't really who they were.
I've seen with my own eyes,
changed documentation on our people.
I don't mean to be rude.
change their race.
Are you Indian?
A lot of our people left here because of the things that he did.
There were legal challenges to this, to the law. And those legal challenges came from people of Indian heritage.
Still didn't believe him. I had to test him to be sure. This is fucked up. But I had a gum wrapper in my pocket, so I balled that shit up and I threw it on the floor. And a single tear came out of his eye. I said, oh shit. I had so many questions. So what tribe are you from? I said, word.
That's typical of what happened to first Americans in the Commonwealth, how things were done to actually change, not only to change one's race, but to change one's ethnicity, to take away their traditions, to take away their cultures, etc.
You see, these are three or four or five people that are buried here.
These are all my family members. Every single person, it's my lineage, my blood.
Most of these people that are buried there, and they were a part of making America grow, helping America to grow. World War I vet, he's buried right here.
That's my grandfather, Leroy Rock.
These are people that were a part of America's history.
The truth is, for a long time, Native Americans were implicitly told that they had a choice to make.
By the time I graduated high school,
by virtue of the long-standing failure to tackle wrenching problems in Indian country, it seemed as though you had to either abandon your heritage or accept a lesser lot in life. But there was no way to be a successful part of America and a proud Native American.
It was so draining, you know.
We know this is a false choice. To accept it is to believe that we can't and won't do better. And I don't accept that. I know there's not a single person in this room who accepts that either.
You know, the birth certificate says Negro, the marriage certificates, et cetera, et cetera. How do you work past that to prove the
Well, prove the government is very sympathetic today in light of what happened to the Native Americans in the 1920s in Virginia in particular. So the federal government and even the state government is very, very sympathetic about that. But I think there's still a pushback as far as the federal government is concerned in extending recognition to them. And even as I've done research in the various county censuses over the years, I had a very frustrating time in coming across some people who identified as free black in one instance and even white in other instances. Mm-hmm. Very seldom are they designated
as Native
Americans, but you see that and you're trying to figure out what's going on. And I know some families who are present day families are, well, I won't mention the family, but because those families, descendants that I know, it probably was a Native American aspect to mm-hmm. that confusion
to the family.
In the early 19th century. Yes.
Your family is your tribe. Tribes form nations. Nations form empires.
Big family.
Huge.
I mean, the Johnsons and the Jeters and the Ruffins and, you know, it's like we'd be hanging at the little bar over there by Marshall's, you know, called Colonial. And Joey Johnson, yeah. Troy, they come in here. Yeah. Hey, guys, what's up? Mm. And Joey, if anybody look like an American Indian, it's Joey.
It's Joe, yeah.
And you got that ponytail.
Yeah. That's crazy how we grew up with them, playing football against them, beefing with them, chilling with them, and never knew that we was family. You know what I mean? It's nuts. Like, how much inter-family marriage goes on around here? You know what I'm saying?
Look, we was talking about that not too long ago. Damn, we got a check medical certificates and shit, cause we must be making love to our own cousins.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yep.
It's like, damn.
Yeah, I got this letter from my grandfather. He wrote to me personally. And I was asking him about, like, yo, where do we come from? What's our family culture? What's our history? So he wrote me a letter. And what stuck out is that he said that we was never slaves and we was always free. Mm-hmm. And that we are the Titus Thompson family from New Jersey. And he said to me in a letter, and I quote, "In fact, all the blacks in Monmouth County, Princeton, Kingston, New Brunswick, Metuchen, and Piscataway are all part of the Titus family, Thompson family. Thompson is his mother's side, Cherokee Native Americans."
Like I said, I've been thinking like a Native all my life, but I didn't never want to expose it because I was in the South. Then I said, well, maybe if I go to New York, I can like more of like expand myself, not knowing that I was going to meet other Indians that more so look like me.
Welcome to Manhattan, land of the hills, land of the Lenape, home of the urban Indian. Yeah, we still here, dug in. We got low a long time ago. They said we died off, yet they still got a classification for us. Wonder why? Urban Indians are Native Americans in the United States who live in urban areas. Urban Indians represent a growing proportion of the Native population in the United States. The National Urban Indian Family Coalition considers the term to apply to individuals of American Indian and Alaskan Native ancestry who may or may not have direct and or active ties with a particular tribe, but who identify with and or at least somewhat active in the Native communities in their urban areas.
Great-grandfather was an Indian chief, Shinnecock, from the Shinnecock Reservation in Long Island, Riverhead. So that's where my mother met my father in Long Island. Dirty just carried his heritage to the limit, you know. We're Indians. I say, and then he used to say, yeah, we're Indians, we sold Manhattan. I said, well, listen, they sold Manhattan for trinkets. So he always said, well, we're gonna try to get it back. I said, Rusty, please. You're not getting it back, so forget it.
Sold Manhattan to the white man, my grandfather. Step up and get knocked right the fuck out. Come to the cookout.
The Bowling Green and with the bull out in the street. That Wall Street, the reason why that name Wall Street was a wall they built there to keep the Indians behind one end of the wall, while the Dutchmen who came in controlled any business on the other side of the wall.
Cuppy here. That's my grandfather. Look at him.
Third from left.
He is right there.
As I said, his family's all over here. We still here. We deep out here.
I work for the University of Pennsylvania as Assistant Director for Opportunity and Access, and also the first coordinator of Native American recruitment. I'm also a past councilwoman of the tribe. I've worked as their director for a number of years prior to working for the University of Pennsylvania.
Tina Pierce Fragoso is Nanticoke Lenni Lenape from Bridgeton, New Jersey. Even in first grade, she found herself educating her classmates and her teacher about her people.
I certainly got in trouble in first grade when somebody says there are no Native people on the East Coast. And I said, well, wait a minute, I'm sitting right here. I really wanted to take the message of my people still being here. I was really fascinated with the field of anthropology because it allowed me to study Native people and for me to be able to tell the stories of my community.
Tina graduated from Princeton University, went on to Stanford to earn her master's degree, and is finishing up her doctorate. She's working hard to make sure the next generation has the Lenape culture to embrace.
Right now, if I'd have still been in the South, you don't see Natives in the South my complexion. saying they native, because they still in the South and they ain't been exposed to the natives here with the dark complexion on the reservation still today. I said, good God, mama was telling the truth.
My lady in the bed last
night. Did you know that?
I had a dream that touched me deep down inside.
Why not?
Oh, yes, I did. Oh. I bet I'm gonna tell the whole world about it. I dreamed that she was gone. And I'm sad about it. Oh, I'm sad about it. Oh, I'm sad about it. I dreamed that she was gone. And I'm sad about it. Do you know? All my pride, and I'm sad about it. Oh, I'm sad about it.
When you're doing genealogical searches, unless you can talk to your ancestors, your parents, your grandmothers, great-grandmothers, and I tell people when I do presentations, talk to the people in the past from whence came I, so I can know how far I still have to go, okay?
A long time ago, but all my friends tried to tell me the wrong that she was doing, but I just wouldn't listen.
What is not known is that the very first reservations were not out west. Usually the typical understanding of the reservation system was that during westward migration, and as the boundaries of the United States continue to extend further and further west, that reservations were set up out west. Well, it's true that they were set up out west, but what is left out of the story is that the very first reservations were here in the east. And as early as the 1600s, reservations were being set up for Eastern Indians. They were, in some instances, not the same as they wound up being in the west. But they were set up. One of the official reservations in New Jersey, set up by the colony of New Jersey and continued into the early period of the federal period in New Jersey, is the Brotherton Reservation, which is in Burlington County. And that was disbanded in the early 1800s.
As a child, I remember different conversations. Say I'm 5, 6, 7 years old. And whenever there was a sharing going on, whether it was with grandmas or with her kids, that, you know, certain words rang true, such as Brotherton. When Brotherton came out saying, yeah, well, they were supposed to be sent there, the problem with the treaties, how treaties were broken, and how grandpops will be to his grandfather or his great-grandfather, ended up having to go to Brotherton with his brothers, and for whatever reason, they didn't feel comfortable with them staying with their tribe. They was making too much trouble. So they made them indentured servants and sent them down to Virginia, in which like four of the brothers were lynched. They don't teach you about Brotherton in high school, okay? They're not gonna teach you that, how they took about the treaties, that sort of fell apart, and in turn to those treaties falling apart. And this is before Walk the Tear, the Trails of Tears.
Yeah, long before.
This is before how people ended up in an indentured servant situation. They're not going to tell you about the protests. But when I went to college, boom, there it was about Brotherton being the first South, you know, the first reservation. Yeah. Wow. And, you know, and certain things rang true.
There had been hostility between the settlers and our ancestors, between European settlers and our ancestors, and in order to help quell some of the hostility and disputes over territory, many of our people were placed in areas and were promised that the land would be kept inviolate. They would not have to worry about encroachment, they would not have to worry about losing their land. And yet, we did.
The intention was that we would live together in peace in Philadelphia. That is a pact that my people have continued. We've never broken it. The agreement was that we would always dwell in peace with the children of William Penn. Sadly, William Penn's own son broke it and swindled our folks out of a vast amount of territory.
She robbed me of all my pride, and I'm sad about it.
But the C's, like I said, the M's, and the ladder to black. By 1900, they were all black. BL, every one of them.
Hey, Sio.
Sio.
I'm here at the request of Dr. Holloway, Chairman-in-Chief of the Sandhill Band of Indians, and his counsel, Ron Holloway. I'm honored to attend this meeting today, September 17th, at 10 a.m. in Trenton, of the New Jersey Commission on American Indian Affairs. I've worked extensively with the community then known as Moores in Cumberland County, New Jersey, to organize the county as a tribal entity. You may speak to Chief Mark Gould, who I encouraged to move back to New Jersey from Maryland to lead his community to later become known as the Ananico Lenni Lenape Indians.
Our existence was through the churches. We were one of the first tribes to be Christianized. And we've always had the toss-up between traditional and Christian life amongst the people in the tribe. We never knew how to adjust to that. And some of the things that in the church, we governed around family matriarchs, and we lost all that. And the elders in the church were the ones that kind of set the rules that we had to continue to live by when there's a change. And then the tribe starting to drift away from who we are.
This was a common story amongst all the tribes in New Jersey. You see, strict laws were passed, laws that denied us the right to live our culture. The moment we left the reservation, we were considered Negroes. So although my family are direct descendants of the Navasinks in the Sandhills, we lost our way as well. We are now trying to find our way back.
Even though there's some distance between us, that when we do get together, we're so cool. Mm-hmm. You know, the family, mm-hmm. You know, and I just think it just goes back to our roots, you know.
Those of us who stayed, especially those of us who stayed here in southern New Jersey, have been referred to by tradition, by our northern relatives up in Canada, as the keepers of the land. That there were families that had partially assimilated, adopted Christianity. Some had gotten deeds to ancient lands that their families had been on for years, and they stayed put. And we are the remnant that stayed put. And the belief was that we would always hold on to the place where the dust of our ancestors bones.
Not in Oklahoma, not in Wisconsin, and not in Canada. We're still home.
There are many who don't understand how important, how sacred, how tied to our identity, our relationship with the land actually is. So we stayed. Our families, our ancestors remain.
He was like, yeah, how they had a huge acres of land, 60 acres of land, 60 acres of land. They had farms, pigs, everything. They worked the land. And unfortunately, they lost the land because of heavy taxation.
Yeah, that's how they did us too. Yeah.
Heavy taxation, they lost the land. And I remember looking at these pictures in the family album. And I asked my mother, I said, Mom, who that? Oh, that's your grandfather's brothers and sisters. I was like, oh, she looked like, you know, she got some native in them. And then my mom was like, yeah, that's because they are. Mm-hmm. And you can see them with the long braids coming down on the back, mm-hmm. and brown skin. And I was like, oh, wow. And I used to go to Jersey for their family reunion back in the 80s.
What part of Jersey?
It was around Monmouth County, Jersey. There was hard workers, farmers, and they had a lot of crops on their land, corn. And one thing he said that, in a letter, that his grandparents used to smoke indigo on the porch. And he said that there was a time, there wasn't a time where they was never wore their moccasins. He always saw them with their moccasins
on. So they was never slaves.
Never slaves.
Got a history of owning land.
Owning land. 60 acres.
60 acres. And when you deal with Monmouth County, like, that's prime real estate. That's the Jersey Shore.
Mm-hmm.
Like, wouldn't have been no Jersey Shore, sure, the television show,
exactly,
without Monmouth County.
Exactly.
Like, that's prime on the family names list, like you said.
We have Ray, which is Ray, my mother's mother. Mm-hmm. Then we got Potter, which is my mother's mother.
Mm-hmm.
And we got Thompson,
Thompson,
which is my mother's father's mother.
See? So now we met through CLECO.
Yeah.
Right? We've known each other a few years now.
Correct.
Right? And we've already connected.
Correct.
Fleshed things out. You know what I mean? Been able to, verify information for each other.
Correct.
Now, your family's migration history consists of what?
My grandfather said that his grandmother is Bertha Farrell, and she was born in Virginia in 1883.
Mm. Now, what part of Virginia?
Culpeper, Virginia.
Culpeper, and that would be, is that western or eastern?
I think it's western Virginia.
Okay.
Southwest area. Okay. Culpeper, Virginia. And her husband was Thompson from Baltimore.
Mm.
And he said they both was full-blooded Cherokee people or whatever.
See.
And they moved to New Jersey. And when they moved to New Jersey, that's where they had the family.
Yeah. All right, so y'all have history of natives moving from Virginia
into New Jersey.
Now, anybody that has done any real research knows that all throughout the 1700s, there's like five different migrations.
Correct.
Of tribes coming from the north, from the south to the north. My family, the Richardsons, was among them.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, so you're saying the Thompsons?
Thompsons.
Right?
Correct.
Now, when we look on our family list of Lenape Cherokee descendants in Monmouth County, New Jersey, we find
Thompson,
Richardson, Ray,
Reeve,
all these names on these lists.
Here's the thing we should be asking ourselves. I don't know the story of these. Do you know that? Did you know that? Why not? Were the American Indians wronged? Yes. Yes. And that's what we focus on in America. The question should be the ones that the founders asked. Who are they? Who are they?
If you were to walk into any mosque in America, and you just laid your hands on the first person or the third person or the fifth person that you see, you realize that you're laying your hands on a Native American?
I believe.
There's a sign when I entered that said Pine Brook Cemetery. If you go down the path a little bit more, there's more tombstones in the woods. They look a little bit more recent than the ones that are over here. Look at this one.
There were only 8% of the slaves that came to America. So, how is it that there are so many more people that they claim a black or African American? I think they got the numbers wrong, because a lot of Native Americans are the ones that they're counting as black folks too.
earliest known family burial markers in Shadow Rest Cemetery in Tipton Falls is one of Abraham Rock, buried in 1774. He was named after his grandfather.
An unprovable one. If you can prove it, I mean, they must have screwed up somewhere along the line, and if that's the case, well,
They.
They
who?
They. I don't know, but that's why they call them they.
Yo, I'm coming in there. I came with the ism, I use it as a prism. Refracts the light, illuminate your mind when you listen. Who shot Kennedy? It came from the bushes. Trade guns for coke, make niggas push it. It's all conspiracy, fact not theory. Y'all don't hear me, y'all rather talk to Siri. The NDAA got me feeling kinda leery. No country for old men, no rest for the weary. Niggas chase paper, but money made of cotton. We used to do for self, but it seems we just forgotten. We could build a nation, y'all content with shopping. I wanna raid the babies, you just wanna get it popping. Don't listen to the radio, don't care who's rocking. Don't care about your label and don't care who's dropping. Everybody wanna eat, but ain't equipped to compete. Understand they execute the plan till it's shocking.
They monitor everything, absolutely everything.
Elaborate on they.
Well, there's lots of groups, actually, lots of initials. I mean, CIA,
yes, sir.
FBI, IMF, you name it. They, the MK Ultra program.
Come on.
You familiar with it?
It was mind control.
Yes, sir. You take an ordinary man and turn him into an assassin. Yeah. That was our goal.
My vision ain't blurry. I read it like a Kindle. Obama's at the wheel and he whipping it like a rental. That nigga is a Mac. They put him there to pimp you. They fuck us from behind, but that's not what I'm into. Martin had a dream, Muhammad had a scheme. Supreme's got a plan that involves a triple beam. Go recruit a team, turn the world to fiends. You can't make it off the block caught with coke in your jeans. Life's a marathon, y'all treat it like a sprint. What y'all gonna say when China asks for the rent? What goes up? Chickens home to roost. Barack got us hanging like Bishop on the juice. I'm so controversial, labels won't touch it. But I do it for the people, so I'm like, fuck it. They did it for the banks, then he cut the budget. But I'm trying to watch the game and I don't want to discuss it.
So you're saying that group one is warring with group two?
Yes, at some levels they're at war. But at other levels, there's the same group. It's really scary. I mean, it's hand in glove. Cold War's hot wars, then they sit back and watch the whole damn dumb show.
Jerry, what? Take a breath.